Right. Do I have your permission to share this video in my online DAT course, Corrective Exercise and Movement Dysfunction?
Yes.
Okay. So what we're going to look at right now is your posture and do a dry assessment of what you look like and how your breathing is going in just normal standing posture. So what I'm going to have you do is take in 5 deep breaths for me in this posture. And then I'll have you turn to your right side and we'll go from there. All right, so start here by taking 5 big deep breaths for me. And what I'm looking for here is any changes in the thoracic cavity or abdominal cavity, trying to see whether he is doing consistent breathing in inhalation and exhalation. I should be looking for the upper thoracic cavity to hopefully have a normal sitting posture and staying depressed while there is lateral expansion of the rib cage. And I should also be looking for the lower abdomen to continue to expand on inhalation. All right, and if you can turn to your right side for me, please. And if you can take 5 deep breaths for me here. All right, so during this normal posture, I can note that my patient does have pretty good posture, has a little kyphosis or rounding of the shoulders up top, and a little bit of a lordotic curve where there is a slight pelvic tilt toward the front. But all other postures are normal. Again, I'm looking for thoracic breathing or dysfunction, and I'm also looking for, again, abdominal breathing. And if I can have you turn your back toward me. I can have you take another 5 deep breaths for me. As I'm looking from the posterior view, it does appear that this subject does have superior translation of the rib cage. It doesn't appear to be a lot of lateral expansion of the rib cage, so there may be a little bit more of a apical or thoracic breathing than what may have been previously noted.
According to Wikipedia.
All right, again from the sagittal view at a little bit of a closer angle, I am just looking for again any diaphragmatic breathing, apical breathing, or if the patient has more of a paradoxal breathing or a combination of both types of breathing. Okay, so again, as we look at the subject, he does appear to have, again, more of a thoracic or apical breathing pattern, as the stomach does not typically fill up with air as it would with normal diaphragmatic breathing. All right, so we just finished looking at the standing posture to pay attention to the breathing patterns. And so now we're going to switch to a seated posture of breathing assessment. And we'll have one view that is looking from the anterior, and then we'll have another view that is looking from the sagittal view, or you sitting on your side with your side facing toward me. All right, so from this view, just keep your hands where they are. You're in a great position. And I just want you to take 5 deep breaths for me. So again, what we're looking for here is any dysfunctional breathing, or again, any types of patterns where there is superior translation of the rib cage, and also looking to see if there is abdominal filling of air. Also noting any type of lateral expansion of the rib cage during the breathing. And now if you can actually turn and swing off of that side there with your legs facing toward the left and you're hanging off the edge there. Okay. Again, you can have a nice comfortable seated posture and we'll note the differences from here. All right, if you can take 5 deep breaths from me here. And if on this view, if you can have your hands to your side for me as well. You don't have to hold on to the table for support, just kind of let them hang. All right, and try 2 more deep breaths for me. Good, thanks. Okay, so we just finished the seated posture view of the breathing assessment, and now we're going to take this to a supine laying view, or where you're laying on your back, again, for an assessment of breathing patterns. So if you can take your right hand and place it over your chest, and if you can take your left hand and place it over your stomach, I want you to pay attention to what you feel when you're breathing. You don't have to say anything or give me any feedback. I just want you to note where you feel most of your breathing when you breathe in and breathe out. Fair enough? All right, so you're going to take 5 deep breaths for me. All right, so note that the patient has more of a diaphragmatic breathing during the supine laying position. As you noticed the deep breath, you got a chance to see the abdomen fill with air. You did see a slight rise in the chest, but it looked to be secondary to the abdominal cavity filling with air. Okay. We are going to change this view for just a moment, just so we can see if anything changes. All right, and if you can take 5 more deep breaths for me, sir. Good job. And so we do see the same consistencies with the abdominal cavity doing most of the filling with air, and the chest is staying pretty neutral. All right, sir. The next test that we're going to be performing is called the side lying hip abduction movement pattern test. What I'm going to be looking for is any dysfunction in your gluteal movement as you do lift your leg up toward the sky, or in hip abduction. So positioning wise, I do need you to be nice and comfortable up top here. If you can bend your bottom leg for me, and we're gonna move this leg a little bit neutral. Can you scoot away from the wall just a little bit? There you go, perfect. Okay. So what I'm gonna have you do here is lift this top leg five times straight toward the sky. It may be a little bit easier to just do normal movement where you are positioned there. Okay. While you are lifting your leg, just make sure you just keep breathing nice and normal for me. Fair enough? All right, so let me move out of the line of view and go ahead and lift straight toward the sky for me five times. We were looking at the subject lying on his left side, and now we're looking at the patient laying on his right side, watching for the left leg abduction toward the sky. In this particular position, excuse me, I'm going to be now looking especially, of course, at what muscles are being recruited first in the movement. Typically, if you see any dysfunction, you'll see instead of the gluteal muscles being activated first, you can see either some of the quadratus lumborum or the low back actually take a little hip hike on the lift. So let's watch as the patient does execute this exercise from this view. All right, so you can go ahead and lift five times for me and just take again nice, good, controlled breaths for me. Be a little difficult to see, but from this view, it looks like the subject has a little bit of anterior translation or a little bit of hip flexion on the hip abduction. So that may be an exhibit of a little bit of tensor fascia latae recruitment instead of the hip abductors or the gluteal muscles. I also did notice a slight hip hike on this side, again, also possibly noting mild quadratus lumborum activation during this, but it doesn't seem to be a huge overcompensation. So we will change the view of this exercise just so I can see it from the axial view and see if we can really notice whether there is more TFL activation or not. All right, so this is the axial view of the hip abduction test, just so we can see if there's any extra anterior translation or hip flexion. And sir, if you again can do five leg lifts, nice and comfortable. That was the left leg being lifted toward the sky on the right. And if you can do me one more favor and flip over onto your left side now, so we can again observe just the right side. Okay, so you're in the same position, bent knee at the bottom, nice and neutral. And again, remember to keep your breathing, don't hold your breath. We are also looking for that as well. All right, whenever you are ready, you are able to lift five times toward the sky. Okay, so with both views, again, there is some slight hip flexion in the abduction movement. So that is noting, again, a little hip flexor tightness, probably a little TFL recruitment. Also noting that there is some slight hamstring flexion while the subject is lifting his leg toward the sky, also maybe be indicative of over activation of hamstring instead of the glutes to help lift the leg up toward the sky. So we may have some possible dysfunction here, and we'll work to try to make some of those corrections here in these next exercises that we're going to demonstrate. All right, so big things with the... Okay, so now that we've done our posture assessment and our breathing assessment, We're going to try to do a couple of exercises that would be related to correcting any type of hip abduction dysfunction. But before we get into those exercises that specifically target that area, it's very important to address core stability and the ability to properly breathe through the motions. So by activating the deep core musculature and of course the diaphragm, which does have some surrounding of the paraspinal muscles and some of our hip flexors and things that are highly active on this subject, we can in turn hopefully kind of give those muscles some relief so that we know how to breathe properly through those exercises and again focus on strengthening what we want to. So the first exercise that we're going to start with is the abdominal hollow and pelvic tilt, but we're actually going to combine this with the Lewitt posture to see if we can get a little bit deeper activation of the core musculature along with the diaphragm. So I'm going to move to the other side of the camera so that we can get a better view and I can instruct my subject a little bit better. All right, sir. So first things first, if you can put both feet flat on this wall surface, we're going to bend you to a 90-90 degree posture. So you're going to have about 90 degrees of flexion in your knees and about 90 degrees of flexion in your hip. So if I can have you scooch toward the wall just a little bit more. So you get to lay comfortably with your arms to your side for right now. And what we're going to do is, again, practice again what's called the abdominal hollow and pelvic tilt. Just for the view of the video, if you can take your right hand and just place it on your chest for me. And if you can take your left hand and place it on your abdomen for me. So this is going to help you as you're trying to control your breathing and feel what you need to. All right, so big things with the abdominal hollow. You want to try to suck your stomach in or do what we call drawing your belly button in down toward the table. Okay, so if you feel it, it should make like a little bit of a cup. Okay? So I want you to practice this just 5 times and see if you can do normal breathing while you hold that sucking in of your stomach. So try the sucking in motion first. So a little bit more of your chest is being filled with air. Try to breathe through that. Okay. Good. I'm going to take over there. And try to suck in just a little bit more for us. There you go. All right. As you're trying to do that sucking in motion, I want you to also try to bear down and brace yourself as if you were going to be punched in the stomach so that you can actually start to feel your rib cage compress. Can you actually feel that? Okay. And I want you to also to continue to try to breathe through that motion. Okay. So if this exercise is being done correctly, I should feel pressure on my hand, or you should feel your back almost starting to flatten out just a little bit toward the table. Okay. And keep taking 2 more good breaths for me while you're holding that posture. So it's a little bit difficult to do. But again, you're trying to suck in your stomach, hold that suck, there you go, while you breathe. Good, and relax. Okay, so this exercise is a little bit difficult to execute, but we'll keep working on that. All right, so where the Lewitt posture comes into place, is that we're actually going to have you just brace your abs instead of doing the hollow. So I want you to take, again, nice, good, comfortable breath. And then you're going to brace your abs as if you were being punched in the stomach and you didn't want to be hit. Good job. So hold that posture there for us while you breathe. So taking a breath in through your nose and out through your mouth. So if you're doing this one correctly, I actually won't feel as much pressure under my hand. Okay. And take another breath in through your nose and out through your mouth. Okay, make sure you're still holding that posture. Keep bracing as if I'm going to punch. Good job. Okay, and again, in through your nose and out through your mouth. And relax. Good job. Alright, so one more progression from this is going to be through an exercise from the Lewitt posture called a forced exhalation. So if you're doing this exercise correctly, you do start off in the same position. You do actually give, again, what's called a forced exhalation, where you breathe in through your nose and you force it out hard through your mouth. You are doing that while you are holding that same bracing position. Okay, so at this point now, you don't need to hollow anymore. All you're doing is holding that same brace position. You're making sure you can feel your rib cage depressed. And then again, you're breathing in through your nose, you're breathing out hard through your mouth. Fair enough? All right. One other added portion to this exercise that makes it a little bit more difficult. This is just a progression of it. You don't have to get it perfect this time, but you'll actually come away from the wall and try to keep your legs in the same posture. So we're taking the wall out of that factor, okay, and trying to hold in the same position while you brace. Take a deep breath in through your nose and force it out hard through your mouth. While you're holding that posture, and I'm gonna let go. Okay, so as you can notice, the patient is working his core very hard and tightly to execute that. Okay, two more for me. Good job. And try to brace extra hard. Keep that rib cage down. There you go. And you may relax your legs down on the table. Alright, so the natural progression from the Lewitt posture and that abdominal hollowing and bracing movement is going to be to move into what is called a 90-90 marching or a dead bug position. So the patient is going to actually start back in that 90-90 hip flexion and 90 degrees of knee flexion posture. Okay, and I'm going to move my way over to instruct further. All right, so from this posture, sir, you're going to try to do an alternation of touching heel toward the table, while the other one's suspended in the air, and then touching the other, okay? You still want to try to keep that same posture where you are bracing and continuing to breathe in through your nose and out through your mouth. All right, you ready? Alright, so you're going to try five of those starting here. So this is one. Good. Try to hold that posture. And we'll keep breathing. Good job. Okay. So again, noting there, you want to make sure that your patient is still staying with that bent knee posture, that they are maintaining that breathing or that abdominal bracing, as well as actually breathing again in through the nose, out through the mouth. So if the patient is doing this correctly, you'll feel a deep core activation along with, again, a little bit of hip flexion there. Okay, so again, these are all abdominal core exercises to set the foundation for breathing and in turn help other portions of the body. All right, so from this position, we are going to transition into something that is a little bit more activation of the glute medius, glute max, and core altogether, and that is going to be what we progress into called a floor bridge. Obviously, we're not on the floor, we're on the table with this patient. So the patient is going to start with their knees bent at about 90 degrees. Okay, so we're going to let you out a little bit more. Big things with this exercise is we don't want the patient to start with their knees bent so tightly as if when they get ready to lift off of the table or bridge up, you can risk a little bit of overactivation and cramping of the hamstrings. So this is again where that abdominal hollowing, that bracing is going to take place. I'm going to set the foundation for this exercise while the patient does end up squeezing glutes and then lifting off of the table. Okay, big things here. We don't want the patient to overlift and in turn have an arch in the back, but to get a nice strong core type lift. All right, so sir, what we're going to have you do is get into that abdominal bracing position. Okay, you're going to keep those breaths going for us in through your nose, out through your mouth. And when you're ready, you're going to squeeze your butt together and you're going to lift straight off the table. Okay, and you can actually lift probably a little bit higher if you're able. There you go. Okay, and you're going to hold for 5 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and relax. Okay. And if you can do 4 more of those for me. And you want to really try to focus more on efficiency through your breathing and holding that core nice and tight as you squeeze those glutes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Good, and relax. Okay. 3 more for us. Make sure you hold those abs nice and strong. There you go. So you can see a definite difference of that rib cage and core. 4, 5. Relax. And 1 more for us. Again, holding that core nice and tight, making sure you're breathing. 3, 4, 5, and relax. Good job. So with all rehab exercises, you always want to progress, especially in this realm, from exercises from a low stability demand, meaning that there is a lot of stability available for the patient, and progress to a higher stability demand where it's a little bit more difficult for the patient to balance. So in this progression, we're going to still do the same floor bridge, but to make it a little bit more difficult or increase the stability demand, we're going to look at giving the patient the instruction to do alternating leg extensions. So basically, it'll turn into a single leg hold floor bridge. All right, so we are going to let the patient, again, start back off in that abdominal bracing position. Good. You don't have to lift out. Okay, make sure you are breathing in through your nose, out through your mouth. And when you're ready, you're going to squeeze your glutes and lift up off the table. Good. And if you can extend your right leg for us. Okay, and you're just going to hold for 2 seconds and come down. Keep that same bridge up. Good. Squeeze and straighten out. After 2 seconds, and come down. Okay, so again, in that exercise, alternating legs will actually change, again, the stability demand. It engages more core activation, as well as engaging more glute activation on the side that is being balanced on the table. Okay, all right, so we're gonna have you perform that exercise 4 more times. And relax. All right, for this last exercise progression for giving some extra strength to the gluteals, we're going to put the patient in a quadruped position and demonstrate an alternating leg extension. So the patient is going to be on all fours. Okay, so knees bent, hands or wrist down flat toward the table. The patient is going to keep a neutral head position, so not extended or not flexed. He should be looking straight at the ground. Okay, the back should be nice and flat. That means that the patient is in that same abdominal bracing posture that we've done in all the other previous exercises. So right now you kind of have a little bit more of a rounded posture. Again, just looking straight down at the table though. There you go. All right. And from here, we're going to hold our abs, breathe, and whenever you're ready, you're going to just take your right leg and extend straight back. Good. And come down toward the table. It does become increasingly difficult. You can alternate. Good. And come down. And if you can do four more of those, one per leg. So again, your goal is to keep those abs nice and tight, keep that core nice and strong. You can squeeze those glutes on that extension. And the goal is to try to not rock from side to side as you bear down as hard as possible. All right, good job. Thanks, sir.